Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown, because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive. Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section. I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Age of Radio.
Fellas, it's good to see you. It's me, Cary Grant.
Oh, Cary Grant. Oh, hey. Hi,
Cary. How you doing, man?
Good. You boys watched a movie last week that I wasn't in, did you?
Yeah, we didn't. I don't know that you're in any movies on the BFI list, Mr. Grant.
Seeing as how you're an American chap.
Well, you know, I sometimes think that I could play British pretty well. You know, I've got accents that I can speak.
That's pretty close to British.
I mean, it's mid-Atlantic proper, of course, you see.
Yes.
But it's the same attitude.
Did you have any thoughts on Withnail and I, or...
You know, I auditioned for that movie.
Okay. Wait, was Withnail going to be a lot older?
That was the original plan, yes, okay. Of course. The director, Bruce. Mm. Bruce, you see, Bruce, old Bruce, came to me. And he said, Cary... I have a role for you. There's a movie called Withnail and I. And I said, Withnail? That's a weird name. And he says, well, we're thinking about changing it to Withnail, but don't worry about it. He said, we'd like you to play an older sort of main character who's had a lot of drugs and done a lot of bad things in his life. And you have a young apprentice in sort of an eye.
You really getting British there, Cary Grant.
Well, you know, I that was what I was going for when I was talking to him. I was trying to be more British than I got into the role, but then production happened sometime in 1987.
Right.
And I had unfortunately died by November of 1986, so I was not available to do it.
That sucks.
Yes, it was quite a disappointment to everyone involved, and I felt quite bad, and I proceeded to haunt the set, actually. And that's why they've all never had any success beyond this film.
Should we tell them about Richard E. Grant?
No, just let him have it.
Yeah, you're right, Cary.
All right, fellas. Well, I'm glad you enjoyed that movie, but you really should watch one with me in it.
We'll try.
Yes, I feel like I must have been in some British movie at some point.
Sure.
But, in Republican Heaven, things get to be a bit of a muddle, and I don't quite remember, so... We don't have IMDb, you see. Richard Attenborough wouldn't allow it. He's an asshole.
Wow, I mean, interesting intro for this episode.
Have you ever, okay, before I go.
Jesus Christ.
Hollywood story.
Okay, Cary Grant.
Republican Heaven. You see, I was up there, and Richard Attenborough came into the club. There's a club up there. It's for white people only. But since there's only white people up there, it doesn't really matter.
Oh, my God. Did Carrie Kane just imply that only white people go to heaven?
No. But Republican heaven.
Oh, okay.
The good one. Richard Attenborough came in one night, and he sat down beside Mickey Rooney. And the two of them had the biggest fight I've ever seen. These two little fellows just rolling around on the ground. And then Richard Attenborough stabbed Mickey Rooney. Now, do you know what happens when you get stabbed in Republican heaven?
Seven lashes.
You die forever.
What?
You're gone. You're dead. Mickey Rooney, his spirit is evaporated. I liked Mickey Rooney. He was a good friend of mine. Anyways, just thought you should know that. So, as a warning to any of your future guests.
Don't get stabbed in Republican
Don't
heaven.
Don't get stabbed in Republican heaven. Jetpack, Cary Grant away!
We learn so much about Republican heaven every week.
Every week, yeah. They like telling us about it. It sounds kind of nonsensical to me.
It sounds like they're just kind of making it up as they go.
I think that's how it runs. I think that's how the government there runs it. Everywhere has governments, even heaven. There has to be a hierarchy is what I'm saying. Please tune into my PragerU video.
Please don't. But Jason, this is a podcast.
It is a podcast!
Podcast about British film. And this podcast is called For Screen
and Country.
And I am Brendan.
And I am Jason.
And I wish you saw what I see, folks, because every week, I want to tell you something right now. When I'm talking on the mic, Jason always looks like he's chomping at the bit. And it's just a sight I wish everyone could see.
Well, it's my own, because I'm just waiting to speak. See, I don't care what you're saying. I'm just waiting to speak words.
It seeps into your head and then escapes.
That's right.
Yeah.
It just expectorates out my orifices.
This is a podcast about British film, like I said. But more specifically, Jason, what is it about?
It is about the films that were placed on the British Film Institute's top 100 British films of all British time, as ordained by our Lord and Savior in the year of our Lord, 1999. And crack a beer to that. And we are over 80 movies through this list of 100 British films. And we still have some bangers to go, Brendan.
We do. And some long ones to go.
Some long ones too, yep.
We have, at this point, after this film, Jason,
yeah,
we have 17 movies left to go.
That's nuts.
17 movies on the list.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
And you folks, you're with us. You're going to be with us right to the very end of this thing.
That's right. And then, you know, we're going to do something else. So don't give up hope, even That's though right. we get through this.
There'll be more screens and countries to cover.
That's right. Nice tease there. But yeah, we're going to talk about a movie this week. We're going to talk about a very interesting gangster thriller type film.
Morality play.
But before we talk about this week's movie, Jason, we need to read some comments regarding last week's film, Withnail and I.
Today!
Comments!
Unlike any other day.
Yeah, we never do this.
We never do this.
First time, special treat for those of you who listen to this, the Unspooled podcast. We are going to... Oh, wait, what?
Nope.
What's that? I'm getting a note from my producer. It's me.
you did. You wrote yourself a note and handed it to yourself.
Don't call yourself Unspooled again. Got it. Okay.
That's right.
Whew. That was a close one. We are going to read some comments, though, Jason. We're going to read some comments from about last week's movie, not from the movie.
No.
That would be weird if we just read parts of the script we liked.
Richard Grant sent us a bunch of observations about the episode.
He did apparently, by the way, during the pandemic, he did apparently a tweet a day of just him doing like a random quote from Withnail and I.
He didn't even have to do that. He could have like trained a bot to do that.
Yeah. No, it was just him. It was just a video of him doing that.
Oh, I see. It still could have been a bot.
He just wanted to have fun. He's probably bored like we all are.
I suppose, yes.
But yeah, comments about Withnail and I as the movie we talked about. Jason, start us off. Who's our first commenter?
Our first comment comes from a repeat commenter, Nancy Rat, who writes, in my top five.
Who writes, writes.
Who writes, writes. In my top five movies, some of the homophobia / sexual assault jokes clearly don't hold up in 2020 or 2021. I don't know when she wrote this comment. Maybe she was just prepared.
It was recently. I think we're not all used to it yet.
That's right.
Jason, get off her back.
But it doesn't entirely ruin the film for me. I know every word and utterly adore it, and I love the desperate balance between the sheer absurdity / humor / existential dread / depression. We want the finest minds available to humanity. We want them here, and we want them now. That is a great line. Thank you, Nancy.
There is some stuff that is has a different skew to it. Watching it with these modern eyes. See with now. These modern eyes see things that maybe weren't problematic before, but they sure are now.
But that's often the strength of a movie that it
How
can.
How dare you interrupt me?
I will interrupt you at any time, sir.
Okay, keep going.
I was going to say, the strength of something that maybe is problematic, but it's like it's so good as a piece of art that it can kind of overcome that. People are willing to forgive it because it is otherwise such a well-made piece of whatever, whether it's a game, whether it's a movie, whether it's a book. Those are the only types of media I'm aware of.
Those are the only ones. You don't play video games.
No. I only play games that originate in ancient Sumeria.
Sure. Our next commenter is also a repeat commenter, our Lord and Savior, Sharon Horwat.
The reason this podcast still exists, she's funded us thousands upon thousands of dollars just every week just to get her comment on
In here. Bitcoin.
In Bitcoin mainly. Yeah. So we're holding
out for a hero?
Yeah, we're holding out for some Bitcoin.
Sharon has said, I have not seen the movie for a number of reasons.
That's okay.
I'm very glad it exists because Richard E. Grant and Paul McGann became established actors because of it. Side tangent, I wish Paul McGann got to do more on-screen Doctor Who stuff because I think he's great, and I cannot wait to see Richard E. Grant in Everybody's Talking About Jamie.
My brother. Everybody's talking about my brother. They made a movie about everybody talking about my brother? What did he do?
Richard E. Grant is playing him. What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, yeah, okay. I mean, I think you might have to put on a couple of pounds. Sorry, Jay.
Well, I mean, Bruce Robinson said his name was Fatty Grant. I'm sure it won't be a hard thing, right?
Yeah, really. If he was, I'm fatter than Jamie, certainly. But, he's a dad now.
What's the next comment, Jason?
Our next comment, Brendan, is from James C. Cameron Silva.
I have nothing son to say. Of filmmaker James Cameron and the Giant Silva, former professional wrestler.
Oh, I was going to say Anderson Silva, the MMA fighter.
No, nobody knows who that is, Jason. Everybody knows who it's Giant too, Silva is.
Sorry, Jims.
Giant Silva.
Jims. Jimmy. Sorry, Jimmy. We don't mean to make fun.
Everybody come see the greatest show. Come on, the oddities. They were great. Continue.
James writes, it's on my list to see. Oh, he must know Sharon. It seems to be a film that is very familiar to my British friends that are vaguely in my Gen X-ish bracket, but I don't think it had any impact here in the States. At least, I'd not heard of it until after I'd lived in the UK. I mean, the only reason I know this movie exists is because in the early 2000s, I was much more of a movie nerd than I am now, and I bought Criterion discs because I was a pretentious dick. And, of course, Withnail and I was one of those Criterions that I did not own, but was hoping to, but never did.
And now you've seen, and you're a better man for it.
I am a better man for it. I saw it on the Criterion service, so it was even better.
Everything came full circle.
That's right.
Robert James Cole says, I love it. I actually have my copy signed by Paul McGann. He's such a nice guy, and his eyes lit up when he found out that I recognized him from this movie and not Doctor Who. I swear we talked for 20 minutes about Withnail and I.
That's interesting. I mean, it is kind of a cult classic, but I suppose you wouldn't expect the general population to have any knowledge of this movie. I mean, We're kind of cool like that. We get it kind of ahead of the crowd, you know, in 2021.
I mean, and we've 30
some odd years after it came out.
And we've also learned over the last few years that fandom can get a bit toxic. So maybe someone not asking about Doctor Who, he was like, okay.
Next comment, Brendan, is from the Sarge, our Sergeant Charger, S.C. Williams Holt. He writes,
He admitted it.
In the Liberian Army. Such a great film. When you have the likes of Richard E. Grant and Richard Griffiths, who we lost far too soon. Well, I don't know about that. He was pretty old. But yes, I'll agree because I love the guy.
I mean, what you're saying basically, Jason, is it was his time to go.
I think what you're saying is that he deserved to die.
I think what you just said is you pissed on his grave after he passed.
Richard Griffiths, we miss you. We wish you were still around, but we understand why you're dead.
We miss you more than Jason does, apparently.
Well, we. Who's the we? The royal we?
Everyone else.
Poor Sarge. Let's get back to Sarge's comment.
Sorry.
Where we left off.
In what's got to be
the best performance of their career, combined with that exceedingly dry British humor. Yes, spelled it with two U's. Good man. Solid. You have dynamite. Add to all of that, some of the most honest portrayals of addiction and excess and an acid-tongued script. It's no wonder it's such a cult classic. When the state of affairs in the world gets you down, especially us city dwellers, just remember, we are indeed drifting into the arena of the unwell, making an enemy of our own future. What we need is harmony, fresh air, stuff like that. Thank you, Sarge. That was fantastic. And that is a good bit of life to live by.
I think you mean, that was fantastic! Huh! All right, we got another comment here from Ross Waldorf, who I'm assuming is very rich.
Or is just a fan of the salad.
Could be. I love this movie. It rivals The Big Lebowski for the title of cult film with the most quotable lines. That long opening shot of their apartment and the subsequent journey into the kitchen makes the film must-see cinema right off the bat. Fuck it! I have such fond memories of Withnail because I saw it with a friend at the Carnegie Hall Cinema when it was first released, knowing nothing at all about it. The unique vibe and quotes from the film that had become so cherished and iconic were evident on first viewing. We loved it. But if you don't watch it, you'll never get to see Danny or Richard E. Grant's wonderful Shakespeare in the Rain, and that would be a real shame.
Yeah, it would. Thanks, Ross. Appreciate you writing in.
Thank you. Hunt. Oh, wait, that's C. William Salt.
Sarge has already been taken care of.
I assume these are all... Do you know all these people military ranks?
I would assume that most of them would be just probably buck privates.
Okay, well, who's next?
Our next comment is from Lieutenant Colonel Steve Chafin. USMC writes... No, he's not for the... I mean, maybe he's in the Marines. He didn't say. Steve writes, I found the easiest way to turn people on to Richard Grant is to describe him as the Benedict Cumberbatch of the 80s to 90s, but before they knew what to do with a Benedict Cumberbatch type. Withnail is a true classic, but I feel like back in those VHS rental days in the U.S., how to get ahead in advertising was by far the easier to find and the better known of the two, even though its reputation has diminished over the years. And Grant is well known for his film diaries, excerpts of which were published in Withnails, a series of anecdotes about Withnail and other roles over the years. It's worth checking out if you're a fan. Well, thanks, Steve. I might have to look up that sometime. One more comment. Let's do this.
All right. Well, mess hall cook David Simpson says, I like it. I just don't love it. Never appealed to me, though I did enjoy watching it. It is definitely a cult film. And here in the UK, when your landlord yells for last orders, someone somewhere will always say, right, we have to work quickly. Or when told they can't be served or that they're closed, says, I demand to have some booze.
I'll have to keep that in mind because I do intend to visit England sometime in my life, and I'll make sure that I keep that in mind so that if it does happen at the pub, I can laugh like I know what they're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. Just do that. Go into a bar. Don't say anything. Just go in and say, I demand to have some booze.
Or I just I want the finest wines, and we want them now.
Fuck it. Well, those are all our comments, Jason. So now comes the part where we need to find out how this movie compares to the United States of America. See, the United States of America was founded, oh God, in 1765?
I mean, 1776 traditionally 1776. Is the date.
Well, 1765 is when they planned it. 1776 is when it happened.
There are lots of dates that you could choose as the beginning of the American Revolution. Was it in 1770, I believe, during the Boston Massacre? Was that the moment that America was born?
America has been a country since 1972.
Yes, that's right.
And they made an AFI Top 100
list.
They came
together in the wake of the oil embargo to fend off the nasty Arab oil merchants.
Yes, 2 years before Taxi Driver was released, America was officially a country. And they made an AFI Top 100 list. And we're going to compare it to the BFI Top 100 in terms of Withnail and I, which is number 29 on the BFI Top 100. So, Jason, pray tell, what is number 29 on the AFI Top 100?
You'll be surprised to learn it's a movie I've not seen.
What?
But I have heard of.
Oh, Jurassic Park.
No, number 29 on the AFI's list is 1944's Billy Wilder film Double Indemnity.
Ooh, that is a good movie. Wow. Well, Double Indemnity is great film noir.
Yeah.
It's not my favorite film noir, but it's really good.
Favorite film noir is The Man Who Wasn't There with Billy Bob Thornton.
Of course. Well, that was well received. I don't
That's
know what the
movie.
Joke
no,
is.
No, it's a good movie. Okay. I just figured that was a weird one to pick.
It's just weird that you picked the critically acclaimed one.
I thought
you were
going to
say The Man Who Knew Too Much.
Oh, with the, yes, Bill with Murray. The Bill Murray, yeah.
Intolerable
Wait,
Cruelty.
No, wasn't that The Man Who Knew Too Little?
Yeah, that's the
yeah,
one.
Yeah, yeah, because The Man Who Knew Too Much is a
the Hitchcock.
Yeah.
Movies.
Yes.
But okay, what I was going to say is, yeah, no, that movie's great, but I, you know what, just for its iconic status, and even as a first, even though I watched it for the first time for this podcast, I got to give it to Withnail and I.
There we have it, folks. Withnail and I wins on the strength of Brendan having seen both movies that we just talked about.
And Jason, why don't you give your reason for your answer?
Double Indemnity was made by Billy Wilder, and I don't approve of guys who use the name Billy. I think he should have gone by Bill or William.
So you're
Withnail and I with Dickie Grant.
I don't approve of that either. All right, well, that's it. Let's wrap this up with a neat little bow. We got to move on. We got to talk about this week's movie, and that, of course, is the Dickie Attenborough hit, Brighton Rock. That's right. We are talking about a movie that is very high up the list. This is number 15 on the BFI Top 100. Is it 1947 or 1948, depending on the time of day and when, what website you're looking up.
And whether you're on the old calendar or the new calendar.
That's right. This film is, of course, Brighton Rock, directed by John Boulting and starring Richard Attenborough.
Yes.
Hermione Baddeley.
Our old pal.
What are some other people in this movie, Jason?
We got William Hartnett?
Hartnell.
Hartnell, who was also known as the very first Doctor when he was an old man.
We have Carol Marsh.
Who is on loan from the J Rank organization.
Isn't that an interesting credit?
It's an interesting credit, but that's because in those days, like, artists were like signed to these ironclad contracts with studios. And I think we've seen it in other movies too, where certain actors are loaned to be in another company's movies.
I really think we should bring that back.
Yeah, you think we should just get rid of the Actors Union altogether?
I think drop the Actors Union, bring back the studio system. It's the only way to do it. Hey, then we can have 12 Marvel movies a year.
That's right. We can work these people to death. 16 hours a day,
Chris Evans, 7 days a week. Just skin and bones, doing more Captain America films. Spoiler alert, he's not in them anymore. So Brighton Rock, number 15. By the way, remember how when we drew this movie out last week, I said the name John Boulting sounds familiar to me. Mm-hmm. And that's because, and this is crazy, because this movie is far removed from this movie.
Is he your dad?
No, he's not my father. The other movie, far removed from Brighton Rock, John Boulting is my father. No, the other movie that he directed on this list is about as far removed from this as possible. He directed I'm All Right, Jack.
Oh, interesting.
Right? Because I remember at the time seeing that he had done both movies, like way back, and thinking, oh, Brighton Rock must be like a comedy too.
Yeah. And while there's a little bit of comedy in this movie that mainly comes from Hermione Baddeley's performance, there's not a whole lot of comedy in this movie.
No, this is a movie that I would call kind of a film noir.
Kind of a film noir,
but there's not really like a femme fatale though.
No,
it's more like it's kind of like a hard boiled detective.
But it really we said morality play earlier, and that's really what it is in a lot of ways.
Yeah,
Graham Greene, who wrote the novel, was a Catholic and pretty confirmed Catholic at this point. He had converted to Catholicism.
Are you saying he was an attractive man, a pretty confirmed Catholic?
Yes, he was very pretty. So he often worked Catholicism in his work, and we get a little bit of that in the movie because they talk about it, how they're both Catholics, and we have this kind of struggle with a person who is quite evil all the way through. There's not really much redeemable about the guy.
No. Well, let's talk about what the basic plot of this movie is, because we have...
First off, I got to compliment this movie. Yet again, a movie that has the credits up front.
Credits.
And not only has the credits up front with the roles, it shows a picture of each of the actors. So I am exactly clear on who everybody is going into the movie.
I first noted Jason is probably going to ejaculate when he sees these opening
Absolutely.
Credits.
Absolutely. Bring it back, studios.
You imagine how long the fucking Avengers Endgame opening credits would have been?
Like fucking Robert Downey Jr. do like a half turn to the camera and be like Robert Downey Jr. as Tony Stark, aka Iron Man.
I mean, they kind of do that in the end credits of Endgame, so there you go. At least the main ones did. Actually, no, everyone did.
Good.
Everyone got a little
thing. I mean, really, Endgame's the one to have your Lord of the Rings 90-minute credit sequence.
Right. But yeah, Brighton Rock. So this movie stars Richard Attenborough, and he plays a character named Pinky.
Pinky. Very young Richard Attenborough.
He is a sociopathic, maybe psychopathic,
yeah.
Mobster, gangster. And basically what happens in
let's be clear. He is a 17-year-old.
17-year-old.
Mobster who is running this mob after the leader of the mob, who was in his 40s, got murdered.
Yes. And to the movie's credit, Richard Attenborough is only about 22 when this movie came out. So he's still very young.
Yes.
Yes. So the leader of the leader of the gang gets murdered. I believe his last name is Kite.
Yes.
Yes. He gets murdered. And it's basically the result of a newspaper article that comes out by this journalist named Fred.
Yeah.
Who posts. Like he posts.
See, I'm used to the millennial,
the modern vernacular. But he puts something in an article that basically raises the ire of a rival gang.
Well, he kind of reveals the fact that the Kite and this gang have been running an illegal slot machine operation. I believe.
And basically, it gets Kite killed.
Yes.
And now they're doing the C-103 fugitive radio gimmick.
Yeah.
it's basically what it is.
But actually, this gimmick, Brendan, for historical context, this gimmick was originally done by British newspaper.
Explain what the gimmick is.
So, what is it? They have a reporter who goes around and there's like a picture of him they put in the paper and he has like a code name and you have to find him. And if you recognize him and properly give him the right code phrase, he hands you a card that is worth a certain amount of money that you can take and redeem.
He also hides cards.
Yes, he hides cards.
And if you pick those up, you get also like a smaller amount of money.
Yeah.
So they see his picture in the newspaper and they say, oh shit, that's Fred. That's the guy who wrote that article, who essentially indirectly got Fred killed, yeah, or got Kite killed. The names are fucking me up.
Yeah.
And then the rest of the movie, very early on, he kills the journalist. Pinky murders the journalist. And the rest of the movie is them trying to cover their tracks.
Yeah.
And of course, there's a Hermione Baddeley comes in. We love Hermione Baddeley. Yeah. She's been in many of the movies we've talked about.
She's an interesting character because she has really no interest in this case beyond being a concerned citizen who just likes a mystery.
She basically becomes an amateur sleuth.
Yeah. She's fucking Harriet the Spy over here.
Yes. I actually wrote down in my notes, if this movie was made today, it would be Rosie O'Donnell. Or it was made in the 90s.
Or it'd be a kid.
I should say. Yeah.
Can't you see that as like a 90s movie, like some kid detective like trying to stop some mobsters who killed a guy?
I don't know if the murder is usually
in 90s. Yes, you could have had murder in a kid's movie.
But she gives me a Rosie vibe.
Yeah.
She really does.
She's brassy, and Rosie's always been brassy.
Always brassy.
Yeah.
Hashtag stay brassy, Rosie.
Like Melissa McCarthy could definitely pull that off.
Yeah. Yeah, I think she'd be fun in that.
Or even a Rebel Wilson.
Yeah, or like a Michael Keaton.
I mean, Michael Keaton can do anything, can he?
I'd like Michael Keaton to just play a brassy woman.
I'm Hermione Baddeley.
Wait, why is he playing the actor?
He's in a biopic about Hermione Baddeley.
That's a project so wild that I'd watch it.
Yeah.
But anyway, so yeah, Hermione Baddeley is like an amateur. She basically becomes like an amateur sleuth throughout the course of this movie. And yeah, it's kind of back and forth. Pinky is like going after this waitress. Anyway, we'll get into it. But he's basically going after this waitress as like the one witness that could put him away.
Yeah, she saw the character of Spicer, who's another member of the mob. He's an older guy.
Yeah, he basically went in to lay out Fred's cards so that people would think that Fred died later on.
Yeah.
But when she sees that he put the card down, she knows that's not the guy in the picture.
And she's got like perfect recall for faces.
For faces, yeah. Yeah. So that spirals a whole other thing. And then the movie just progresses. And I got to say right now, Jason, I don't care. I don't fucking care if this spoils the ending.
Yeah.
This is a fucking perfect movie.
Yeah.
This is a wonderful movie.
It's a great movie, yeah.
It is like so succinct.
Mm-hmm.
It moves like a modern film. Point A to point B to point C. Like it's just everything is like, I just think it's like perfectly laid out. It reminds me of like Lady Vanishes, where I was just saying, like in that movie, the script is so fucking tight.
Mm.
You know, like everything matters. Every little moment matters. Like Hermione Baddeley's character, Ida, yeah, she has this laugh.
Yes.
And the laugh is like a big part, right?
Yeah.
You hear the laugh and you know she's in the scene. At the very beginning, and I only realized this when I was pulling clips for this episode.
Yeah.
But at the very beginning, when Pinky is just in the bar, when they found Fred.
Yeah.
And they're harassing the journalist, being like, you know, we know what you did, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You hear just faintly in the background her laugh.
Yeah.
So you know, like,
you
oh,
also,
she's in that. Well, yeah, you she's, know she's singing.
She's singing,
but
yeah,
before that, you just faintly hear her laugh. And it's like, oh, so they're telling us she's in the scene.
Yeah.
You don't see her face, by the way, when you show that she's singing. You just see the back of her head.
Mm-hmm.
But then later on in the movie, as you see that Hermione Baddeley is also a singer,
yeah,
an entertainer, you're like, oh, was that her?
It was funny with her being a singer. Like for the longest time, we're not exactly I wasn't exactly sure what her role was because she just seemed to be this drunk lady that was having a good time. Like that's all she seemed to be doing, like a socialite. But then at one point, she shows up and she's wearing this ridiculous like
clown
like,
outfit?
Yeah, this weird, like, well, she's not totally in a clown outfit, but she's wearing, like, this chest piece that is clearly, like, a clown outfit kind of thing. And I thought, oh, does this lady just have a weird sense of style? But then it turns out that she's in this, like, review, because Brighton, of course, is a tourist town, even to this day in Britain, and they have beaches there and stuff. And she's in, like, a review that is playing on the beach to tourists.
And if you don't believe us, let's take a listen to this song, because it's great.
You got
to
hear it.
Hello, hello, how are you? Pleased to meet you. Hello, hello, the promenaders greet you with Merry Christmas, song or two. It's always our endeavor to every year provide for you a show that's clean and clever. Hello, hello, it's Brighton air that braces. Hello, hello, what rows of smiling faces. There's lots of fun for everyone.
Now, Ida Arnold is my name, good-hearted Ida's me. The boys say I am just the type to take upon a spree. I'll meet you any night you like and have a glass of port. And if you're henpecked, you'll agree that Ida is a sport.
Hello, hello, it's bright and air that races. Hello, hello, what rows of smiling faces. There's lots of fun for everyone, the cheery, merry old. So on here, the boys and just hello, hello, hello.
I have a question. Why is she required by her bosses to say her real actual name while she's singing the song? That seems unsafe to me. Now, I get it. She's being, especially because she's being all cheeky.
Jason,
right?
Did you see how many people are watching? Like
that's
seven.
True. That's true. There's like seven. But like a girl even makes the intimation that she might like to be down to fuck in 1947 or 48. And she's going to have guys lined up at her door.
But I mean, you can't just look up her name on Facebook.
That is true. But that is a big advantage in 1947, 48.
That Facebook was invented?
Yeah, it was invented back then. Mark Zuckerberg is actually quite old. But he's mastered anti-aging technology, but just won't share it with us.
Well, because that's because of his involvement in Pizzagate.
Mm. You know what? You know what I've noticed? Why is it that Mark Zuckerberg is the one billionaire that's not like just jacked like Hulk Hogan? Because like Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos are just totally jacked.
Probably because he's like, I don't need to be.
I mean, yes, but he should because I think it'd be hilarious. Oh, I want to see him fight Elon Musk.
I think it's because I don't really need it.
Do you want to fight? I'll take you down.
Block.
I shoot a rocket at a Jew. I know that's not really, like, fair, but...
Shoot a rocket at a Jew? Wow, Elon Musk really doesn't like Mark Zuckerberg.
Oh, I better get out of here.
So, speaking of Jewish people, there's religious themes in this movie.
Well, not Jewish religious themes, certainly.
No, but it's one of the religions.
Well, so do you know the central metaphor of this movie? Because I didn't realize this until I read it. With the title, Brighton Rock. Brighton Rock is not a place.
No, and it's based on a quote said by Hermione Baddeley in the film, I think.
Well, do you know what Brighton Rock itself is?
Do tell.
It sounds like a drug. It's not a drug. It's candy.
Okay.
It's like
filled with drugs.
Well, from what I understand, it seems to be a candy stick of a certain length, like almost like a candy cane that's not a cane.
Okay.
But it is made in such a way that if you bite into it, like on the inside of it, you can see like a name, usually like a brand name. And no matter where you bite it, you can kind of see it because it's been like pulled through the candy that way.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the idea is that that's representative of Pinky and that he's the same all the way through. He's not a guy where he has like a secret depth to him. He just, what you see is what you get. He's kind of charismatic when he wants to be, but ultimately he's a piece of shit.
Yeah, and Jason, I feel like we've done a lot of these movies recently where the main character is a villain.
Mm.
Like we did, we talked about Get Carter. We talked about even to some extent, like Withnail.
Yeah, I read a
and performance.
I read a story that I read like an article that described him as an anti-hero, and I'm like, he's not really an anti-hero.
There's nothing hero about him.
No, he's not using bad means to get to accomplish something like good. He's just being an asshole. He's a villain. He just happens to be the protagonist because we're following him.
This is crazy because I also read like I think it was like the summary in IMDb, and it said something along the lines of like he kills someone and then the guilt like leads him down a path, and I'm like, that's not what happens.
I never got the sense that he was ever guilty about that shit.
No internet, you're wrong.
Yeah, like he's not a guy that has any comeuppance. He has no,
well,
I mean, so he has a little bit of comeuppance, but it's not really even comeuppance. It's just he dies.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah.
Holy shit, Jason. Yeah. Way to ruin the movie. but religion in this movie, because like you said, so we should probably talk about Pinky a little more because Pinky is Which is he a sociopath or is he a psychopath? I would say sociopath.
Well, sociopath.
Can he be both?
Well, yeah, probably. I mean, I'm no psychologist. I can't necessarily give you a dictionary definition, but I mean, he's clearly willing to do whatever he wants, and he's clearly willing to do whatever he thinks is necessary for the job that he's doing, because he's willing to murder a journalist over this thing, or at least encourage his death.
Well, and I say sociopath, just some of his dialogue, it just seems to me. So basically, when this guy Spicer, he's also in the gang, and he's going to, you know, like we said, he's leaving those cards all around so that they think that the journalist died much later and he won't be blamed for the death or whatever.
Yeah.
He places one in the restaurant, and Pinky, of course, is like, that's a stupid idea. Someone could have seen you. So Pinky goes into the restaurant to try to find it, and that's when he kind of meets Rose, who says, you know, oh, guess what? I found one of those cards earlier, but it was left by a man that looks nothing like the picture.
Yeah.
And I want to play that scene just so you can get an idea of kind of that dynamic and how Pinky talks.
You'd never guess what I found here only 10 minutes ago. One of Collie Kipper's cards worth 10 shillings. The other girl said I was a fool not to challenge him.
Didn't you?
I never thought. It wasn't a bit like his photograph.
Maybe the card had been there all morning.
Oh, no. I just changed the cloth before he come in because the other customer upset his coffee.
Maybe you just didn't look at him close.
Oh, I always look at you close. Customer, I mean. You see, I'm new and I get a bit scared. I wouldn't want to do anything to offend. Like standing here talking while you want a cup of tea.
Well, that's all right. Don't go away. I like a girl who's friendly. Some of these here, blimey, they freeze you.
They freeze me too.
You're sensitive like me. I wouldn't say anything to anyone about that man, you know, not being like the photograph. The newspaper might say there was a mistake, and then you'd lose your 10 bob. What's your name?
Rose.
You and me ought to get acquainted. You got a boy?
Not yet, I haven't.
I'll meet you on the Palace Pier Sunday night by the concert hall, 9 o'clock, all right?
I have to be back by 11:30.
Okay. Yeah?
But what about your tea?
I just remembered I got an appointment, 2:30 sharp.
You should have stopped me.
Oh, that's all right. I shan't be too late. You send your card in quick and get the money. See you Sunday. Maybe you wouldn't know me again when you saw me.
Oh, I'd never forget a face.
So that's the kind of character he is. That's him pretending to be human.
Hmm. Yeah, and you're right. Maybe that is indicating that he is a psychopath, because he has this kind of...
Or sociopath, you mean?
Well, psychopath, too.
Oh, psychopath, yeah.
Where he doesn't know how to feel, but he's able to effectively pretend and... use that to manipulate this girl for his own ends, which is what he's doing from the start.
And there's weird things he says to her later and stuff, because he asks her if she's ever been in love.
Yeah.
And she says, oh, yes, of course. And she's 17, too. And he's just like, oh, you're very green. And then he goes, and then he says,
I'm such an old hand at this.
Well, no, but he says, you don't know. And he's like, I know love. I've seen it. Like, it's just like, it's very much like, you know, I've read a book about it. I'm aware.
I watch Saved by the Bell. I know how relationships work.
Yeah. It's very much like I'm learning what I'm supposed to do in this situation.
Yeah.
Also, the religious stuff too. Okay. So they both, basically there's a scene where she pulls something out of her purse and the cross falls out.
Yeah.
And it's revealed, basically, they both reveal to each other that they're Catholics. And of course, you know, Pinky says something like, I don't understand atheists or something like that. But then then we get the idea that they're both Catholic. And Pinky doesn't drink. He doesn't smoke.
Yeah.
And then she says, oh, you're a Catholic. And he says, yes, of course, I believe there's a hell, damnation, burning, eternity. And she's like, well, and a heaven, right? And he's like, ah, maybe.
That's the fucking linchpin line right there. That's him in a nutshell, that he believes in all the bad stuff, but the good stuff is just doesn't really even enter into his consciousness, because he knows he's smart enough to know that it's not going to matter for him.
Right. It's almost like he believes, like, no matter what, I'm going to hell, so fuck it.
Exactly.
And it's interesting in this movie, because, like you said, Graham Greene has this kind of religious, like this this Catholic background, and there's a lot of more in the book.
Well, not Catholic background so much as like in his life he was an atheist up until he was 24, and he married a girl and he converted to Catholicism for her, and I guess some people argued, gave him enough arguments that he thought, okay, they make sense, and that's the way he went. So great for him. It resulted in him being one of, you know, Britain's greatest novelists.
Well, the thing I was just gonna say, the thing about that though is that the character that Hermione Baddeley plays, Ida Arnold.
Mrs. Brown's boys.
Yeah, sure. But Ida Arnold is like this, and she's kind of a morality. She's a real sort of morality center, but not in any kind of religious way.
No, which is, which is interesting. I read this, and in the book too, specifically, that is the case, that she is kind of a contrast to the rest of the characters, and that she's a non-religious morality. That is.
I wonder if it's like a criticism of the two extremes, because we have Pinky, who claims to be this, you know, devout Catholic, but obviously on the wrong side of that. Mm. And we have Carol Marsh, who plays Rose, the waitress. And she seems to be, she's obviously a Catholic, but she's almost like too forgiving.
Yeah.
Naive. Naive, young.
This might be the most naive female character I've ever seen in a movie.
But I really like her in this movie.
Oh, she is great.
Carol Marsh is great.
Also, folks, another one of those movies you can watch and be absolutely 100% sure that every single person you see on screen is dead.
Yeah, unfortunately. But again, this feels like another movie to me. I actually wrote down at one point that this almost gives like a Hitchcock vibe, just because this movie is so like... I feel like this movie has a modern pace. I feel like this movie feels like they wouldn't have to change a whole lot for it to be released today. And I know there's a remake, which we'll talk about one day.
Oh, and fun fact I forgot to mention too, the character Pruitt is played by the same actor who plays Mr. Memory in 39 Steps.
And that must have been it. It just attacked my head, and that's like,
boom.
Hitchcock. But yeah, so... What do you think about the thing? The one thing that I noticed with Pinky, a neat little thing they had him do, or maybe it was Richard Attenborough's idea.
Yeah.
He's always playing with this string.
He's doing like Cat's Cradle. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, and when I saw that initially, of course, being a video gamer and having played the Hitman games, I assumed that that was like his Garrett wire and that he was going to strangle some motherfuckers with that. But no, that was just kind of his little bit of physical business that he does, is kind of a little thing that kind of must kind of keep him centered, keep him calm, keep him from lashing out at a given moment. That's the impression I got.
Yeah, well, yeah, and he only seems to do it in scenes where he seems like he's going to burst at the seams.
He's anxious, yeah.
Like, at the very beginning, that's how we're introduced to him.
Yeah, when they're, like, going into a conflict situation, and he's doing it to kind of, like, probably as an intimidation thing, too, because it's just a thing he's doing, but also for his own benefit.
But, like, the first scene we see of him, it starts on his hands, doing the, playing with, you know, with the string or whatever, and then, you know, slowly we see his face, and then he doesn't talk for a while.
No.
Until they confront the journalist, and this happens.
We've been looking for you for a long time, Fred.
I'm not Fred.
That don't make any difference.
Where are you going? Listen, have a drink. Come over here and have a drink.
You know Pinky don't drink. You forget such a lot. You won't be able to remember anything soon.
Just one drink. Have a soft one. The governor, two scotch and a grapefruit. I'm only here on my job. Just one day, see? I'm Collie Kibber.
You're Fred.
All right, then. I'm Fred. But I've got a card in my pocket. It's worth 10 bob to you.
We know. We was reading about you in the paper this morning.
Here, take this messenger. You can have the old prize, 10 guineas. And I'll give you a fiver, too. That's all I got on me, that and my return ticket.
You won't need that return ticket now, will you, Fred?
Won't anybody shut that brass's mouth?
Oh, we must live for tomorrow.
Hey, what's the idea?
The gentleman will pay.
Some Han Solo shit there. The gentleman will pay.
Yeah, and that's the first we hear of him, is him yelling, "Will somebody shut that brass's mouth?" And that's such an interesting way to start with him, because that ultimately is his undoing, is that Hermione Baddeley, who we hear singing, Ida, won't shut her mouth, and that's why eventually, you know, she gets to it. She figures it all out.
It's kind of an interesting like expression of his direct misogyny right out of the gate, because it's just some brass. It's not a person. It's just some lady. This fucking singer. It's some brass, and of course he's very much the, you know, they're all mobsters, so they call girls skirts.
Yeah,
and based on his interactions with Rose, he clearly sees women as a tool to be used for whatever his ends are.
Well, because this is where we end up going is that with Rose, we talked about how she, you know, she has, you know, good with faces. She recalls that it wasn't the guy in the picture, and his idea is to marry her, seduce her, and marry her so that she can't be forced to testify against him in court.
Yeah,
because a wife can't, you know, doesn't have to testify against her husband.
It's like an arrest development. Fucking line, because isn't that something that come under Arrested Development where it's like, yeah, the wife doesn't have to testify against the husband?
I think so.
Yeah, which I think is a thing in English common law, but I don't know so what I'm saying is, if we have any lawyers that are listening, especially lawyers that wear wigs, please let us know.
I don't think it's in America. I think that's Jeffrey Tambor's critical error.
The same guy that said I committed a little light treason.
Right. Also, RIP Jessica Walter. Jeez, that was
yes,
recent.
Yes. And RIP Tawny Katane.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. R.I.P. all those Palestinian children.
Yes, for
yeah,
sure.
No,
but
for
it
sure.
Sounded like you were about to do a bit, and I was
no,
like,
no, no bit there.
Bit.
Just, hey, Israel, fucking knock it off.
Yeah. It's also a good way to introduce Pinky in that scene, because it shows... Because at first I thought, I was like, okay, he's going to be like the cool, collected guy heading up this mob. Like, he's going to be dangerous, but he knows what he's doing and he's got everything under control. And he is not. He is out of control. Like, he's the only one in this scene that makes a scene.
Yeah.
Like, if he had not made that scene, they might have gotten away with everything.
And that's the thing that I think they're missing. So, because in this movie, the only person that Pinky seemed to have any, like, respect for, or, like, any, like, even deference to, was Kite, who's the guy that's dead. Kite was the original leader of the gang.
Kind of William Hartnell's character a little bit, yeah.
He seems to be the only guy that's actually his friend, like that actually kind of gets along with him specifically and isn't like seen as an underling.
But even he is like, this guy's bad news.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the thing, is that the rest of the gang, the reason why he's in charge is, like many gangs, they're afraid of him.
Right.
And he is able to, you know...
So do you think he was like... Was Kite like a father figure to this guy? Because, I mean, I thought it weird at first. I thought about it and I was like, this is a 17-year-old gangster that suddenly becomes the leader when this guy who's like in his 40s passes. So he must have been like a really close.
Yeah, he must have been like in a sort of mentor-mentee type of relationship. And clearly, given how angry he is, like, I don't think he's ever that mad about anybody else dying in the movie. He doesn't give a shit about anybody's lives except for this dude.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what sets him on this path, is this anger, because that's what makes them go after Fred in the first place.
And I need to point out too, because the scene where they, so the journalist, it's a great open, I love the whole movie, but the opening like 20-30 minutes is so fun, because Fred is like running through the streets.
Yeah, there's some really cool shots of Brighton.
Yeah. And it's really like, again, it's a very like modern style shots. Yeah. Like it feels like a modern movie. Just
feels like a Hitchcock movie, like you say.
It does.
Got that vibe to it of like the guy on the run, you know?
The chase. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if this had been a Hitchcock movie, like that would be, it would be his movie for like the whole movie.
Yeah.
But, you know, he dies like 25 minutes in. Yeah. But he's running around and it's really well shot. And then the scene where they finally get to him. Oh, well, we should say that he goes up to a couple of ladies before that. And, you know, he tries to, like, basically get people to be near him and talk to him and stuff. So
just to keep him from getting separated from everybody so that he was vulnerable.
And that's the whole thing with Hermione Baddeley, with Ida, because he finds her and they have a conversation. And she's very boisterous and fun. And,
of course, she assumes, like any, I assume, woman at that time would assume, is that he's trying to pick her up.
Yeah, and she just thinks the whole thing is funny.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, she's just having a fun time. She's like, oh, well, let's see what happens.
Yeah, exactly.
But and then eventually he, you know, she goes off to do something for just a few seconds. He gets on the ride that's like the Dante's Inferno.
Yes, it was like a haunted house type ride. Yeah.
Yeah, and then Pinky quickly takes the guy that's sitting beside him out of there and sneaks into that chair. And then it's such a great moment because, you know, Fred doesn't know. And then the ride starts. He just turns around. And then right there, he's like, I'm dead.
And then we have this cool sequence of them going through the ride and having like these superimposed like ghosts and goblins and things that you might see in this ride. And he's like holding on to Fred. And then, it's just the series of cuts implies that he gets dumped into the water.
Yeah.
Because they're on the beach, right?
So no, that was really, I love that part. It was almost like, it's Dante's Inferno. So it's literally a descent into hell.
Yeah.
And again, we have that scene later where he talks about, I believe in hell.
Yeah.
And that it's just an interesting tie into the religious shit.
I like to think that Pinky literally thinks that hell is that ride.
He's just like, this ride fucking sucks. I'm going to kill him on this ride.
No, I know this ride is hell. This is the literal hell that we talked about in church.
I'm going to open up a park for dinosaurs. We should say that also right now, establish, if it wasn't obvious, Richard Attenborough is fantastic.
Oh, yeah. No, he's great in this movie.
He's so cold. There's like, it's like when you look at someone's eyes and there's nothing there.
Yeah. Well, no, and it's like you think about like even just his little tiny role in Matter of Life and Death. He just was such a jovial like kind of guy.
Very quick.
Yeah. Or of course, we think about his later work like as John Hammond. And of course, John Hammond he played was a very jovial, like kind of like warm, grandfatherly type character.
And I know you said, we were watching the clip and I know you said, oh, I can see the face, like the young face. I can't. Like, I can't see John Hammond. I think it's just because he's so radically different in this movie, and he's so young. So smooth-faced, so young, and such a monster that I just can't put him and John Hammond together.
But of course, I see Richard Attenborough, and I think he was a little short, and he kind of reminds me of Mickey Rooney in a similar way. They're both redheaded dudes in this black and white era. They're both kind of short dudes and kind of, I think, filled similar roles. Surely Mickey Rooney must have tried to play a gangster at some point.
I'm sure he has.
He must have to break because he was in all those like family pictures, like the Andy something or other. He was like
Andy Griffith.
No, but he was like the son of this dad who was like a pastor, and they had adventures.
Also, we talked about Richard Attenborough in another movie on this list when he was in Elizabeth. Even in that movie, he's like a much warmer character, right? And I mean, I guess he looks a lot more like John Hammond in that movie because it was 4 years after Jurassic Park.
In his older years, yes, he very much filled those sorts of roles.
But yeah, that's why it's so weird for me to see him in this. And apparently, the role that got him this role was in Which We Serve.
Where he plays the young Stoker that is kind of cowardly in battle, but Noel Coward's character, basically gives him a mercy to be like, hey, look, we've all fucked up, but don't do it again.
And he redeems himself and then I ends up dying at the end of that movie. And apparently so this is the crazy thing, though. That got him this role, but he had actually played this character before. Like, he had played it on stage. The director of this movie, John Boulting, had no idea. He just saw In Which We Serve, and he was like, I love this guy. Let's get him for Pinky.
And then brings him in for the audition and is like, wow, you're really good at this.
You almost like you played this character before.
Like, wow, we didn't even give you the sides, and you were already reciting the monologues.
Well, I have. Also, Hermione Baddeley and William Hartnell both reprised their roles from the play.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Crazy.
So you're very. I think those two were hired. It's weird. I don't know how he didn't know.
But again, like you said before, back then there wasn't any Facebook. It wasn't like you could just look these people up and see all their connections to your friends. You just had to kind of, hope that you got the best of the best when you were auditioning people.
The best around.
Nothing's ever gonna keep you down.
You're the best
around. I can't get that high. I mean, I can get pretty high, Brendan, but I can't get that high.
See off mic moments, but you can't because they weren't recorded.
They're only for us. Maybe that's something we could offer someday as an insider thing. We record our...
I feel like we'd get canceled.
We record our smoke sessions.
I don't know. I still have to edit those down.
Yes.
There was, so we talked about Pinky a lot. Let's talk about Hermione Baddeley because she's wonderful.
She is great. She is brassy and broad. She's just, she's an independent, strong woman in a time where that was less common.
Yes. And I think she's, and I never knew this, by the way. Do you know that she's in Mary Poppins?
I saw that in her list. I didn't realize that. I don't know the last time I've ever watched Mary Poppins, if I have. It's probably as a child if I did.
But I had no idea.
Yeah, I think she has a relatively small role. She plays like a housekeeper or something. But
yeah, I mean, the first thing I think we saw her in was Room at the Top.
Yeah,
and that was the movie where she
that was
on
where
screen
she had 5 minute scene
and was nominated for an Academy Award. Yeah,
deservingly so. And of course, she was in Passport to Pimlico.
And she's, I would say, she's one of the leads.
Yeah, no, 100%. Yeah, no, she is the driving force of this movie.
Yeah. She's big and brassy, like we said. Well,
because
she's...
without her, a lot of stuff wouldn't have gone down the way it went down, because she was trying to figure out what was going on, and I'm sure that Rose would have been dead by the end of this movie if she had not been involved.
And I love Hermione Baddeley's just her overall style. Can we just listen to her talking to the journalist,
yes,
like just before that whole, you know, he gets murdered? This is how she kind of talks to him. She's a fun lady.
Yes, absolutely.
If it isn't Horace himself. Where are you running on to, eh?
Would you like to sit down?
Well, if you've got sixpence, I haven't. Would you believe it? I put my bag down for half a second, and when I look, there isn't any bag. First me gloves, then me bag. What'll I lose next? Oh, I don't know what I'll do for money. I have to borrow 10 bob from someone till I get paid.
Here. Have this.
Oh, now, really, that is kind of you, dear. Here, what's your name?
Fred.
Fred? Whoever pinched my bag will wish he'd never been born. I'm a sticker where right's concerned. Sure you can spare it.
Had a good day yesterday, Lester.
Here, can you give me a tip for Brighton Saturday?
That boy? The 4 o'clock?
He's 10 to 1.
Well, take it or leave it.
Oh, I'll take it. I always take a tip. That's my system.
Come back to London with me.
What, now? You sick or something?
Yes, I'm sick.
Oh, go on. You're kidding, aren't you, Fred? Men are funny with me that way. Think I'll mother them, I suppose.
Just stay with me, won't you? Even if I'm not sick.
Dear, of course I will. Call me Ida. I like you, Fred. I liked you from the moment I met you. You're a real sport, Fred. Come along, dear. Let's have a bit of fun.
You won't leave me, even for a minute, will you, Ida?
Not for a minute, Fred.
I love it. I love it.
Also in that scene and other scenes in the movie, where there's another old friend we haven't talked about that we've seen, and that's the Brighton Pier.
Okay.
Yeah.
Before you tell me, because I have a question, because sure, it reminded me of one particular movie.
Yeah.
Was this movie in Mona Lisa?
That's 100% was
Thank
in Mona
you.
Lisa, yes.
Okay. Because this is the scene in Mona Lisa where Bob Hoskins confronts her,
yeah,
right? And is like kind of getting violent and shit.
And you feel like it probably is a direct reference to this movie just because they're both gangster movies, and it seems like that would be. But it's also a great place to, like, it's a cool, really cool place. And then even, I think even now it looks very similar.
Is there another movie that you were going to, that it was from?
That was the one I was going to mention. Okay. But I know I've seen it in other films before because I'm always like, oh yeah, that one from Mona Lisa. Yeah. But so Hermione Baddeley in this movie, we just heard her speak. She's such a great character, so strong, so independent, and again, not a sort of female character we see as much in those days. But we got to talk a little bit about the contrast in Rose. Rose has to be the most naive female character I think I've ever seen in a movie. Like, it's like, yeah, he's 17, and I don't believe he's 17. I believe he's older than that. But she says she's 17. It's like, no, she's like 12.
Oh, wait, hold on. You're saying the character is not 17?
I'm saying certainly not mentally. I like she comes across as a child.
Sorry. You're saying that in this movie,
yeah,
Pinky is lying about his age.
Well, I don't think he's actually lying about his age. But when he said he was 17, I was just like, come on, bud.
Richard Attenborough was only about 22.
He was only about 22, but like this guy clearly has is wise beyond his years for the experiences that he's had, and yeah, certainly not comparable to a modern 17-year-old, and certainly beyond even a contemporary 17-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sure. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But I know what you mean. But Rose is this character, and yes, she's so naive, but it makes sense in the context of who she's presented as, because
yeah,
she's very young, and she's also, like we said, very Catholic.
Yes.
Very, very guarded.
Clearly very sheltered.
Yes. And so you kind of, I think you kind of accept that of how naive is. And that might make her, I think, the most tragic character this entire movie.
Tragic, yes, absolutely, and we'll discuss why when we get to the end,
and we'll debate that,
yeah,
because I've heard different sides of it. So yeah,
so maybe we should head toward that place toward the end of the movie.
Well, let's talk about one key scene before we get there, because there is a scene. So again, Pinky is like, this girl Rose, she is gonna be a problem if I don't, you know, take care of this. So he kind of romances her a bit, and eventually gets her to agree to marry him.
Yes.
Through a form of intimidation as well. At one point, there's even a little subtle thing where that earlier scene where we listen to Hermione Baddeley singing, there's a scene of he's holding onto her wrist.
Yeah.
And it's not super obvious, but after he holds her to wrist because he's freaking out, like, what did you tell her? What did you tell them? Yeah. And then after he lets go, she kind of does a quick, like, you know, rubbing her wrist to make sure it's okay. But so he gets her to agree to marry him. And then they decide, she says, oh, you know, it'd be a fun romantic thing is if you record this message onto a gramophone for me. So, yeah. So they go to this place and he records this recording for her because she wants him to record this lovey message for her, even though she knows she's never going to be able to play it because she doesn't have a thing to play a gramophone. Now, the thing you got to think about when you're listening to him say this horrible thing into the recording is that the shot is like of her face up against the window, and she looks so lovelorn, and she looks so happy, and tears come out of her. And it's the saddest thing.
Yeah, as he's saying what he's saying through the soundproof booth, so she can't actually hear him.
Yeah, and thank God she's not a lip reader, because the whole operation would be over. Let's take a listen to what he says.
You asked me to make a record of my voice. Well, here it is. What you want me to say is I love you. It is the truth. I hate you, you little slut. You make me sick. Why don't you get back to Nelson Place and leave me be?
It's brutal.
Yeah, it's brutal. Using the word slut in 1947-48.
That caught me off guard a bit, too. Yeah. I think that was in that cushy time period where you could still use it.
Well, this movie kind of gives me the impression that this was still in a time when the idea of like a rating was still in flux of what was acceptable movies and not. Because I know this movie was controversial for the slashing scenes in
it. It's violent.
So something we haven't discussed is that the gang that they're in is a racetrack gang.
Mm-hmm.
Which I guess they operate around racetracks and they cause fights there and stuff. So I don't know exactly what the purpose of a racetrack game. I Googled race gang and got a whole bunch of different stuff.
Yeah.
Not related to racetrack gangs. So they operated around racetracks. And at one point, so we have the character of Spicer, the old guy who had gone and placed the
card. Not Sean.
No, not Sean. I wish it had been Sean.
You mean because of what happens to him?
Yeah, yeah. He goes, so he's the guy that places the card, and of course Rose saw him, and he's becoming a liability, and he's an old guy, and eventually ends up with him wanting to leave, like he wants to leave town.
He's like, I'll go disappear for a while.
Yeah,
and so. If you need me out of here.
And he's like, yeah, all right, that's great, but come with me, we need to get out of the racetrack, we need to take care of something, so we'll deal with that, and then you can get out of here. And so they go down to the racetrack, and then so we haven't even talked about.
The other gang.
The other gang.
The Colleoni gang.
The Colleoni gang. Colleoni's another gangster that Pinky has been in touch with, and he got his help to try to kill Spicer. And
also, the Colleoni gang, modeled after a real gang, the Sabini racetrack gang of the 1930s, which used straight razors. That was their thing. They always used straight razors, and that's what happens. He gets cut in the cheek, right?
Yeah.
A former Sabini gang member actually served as the technical advisor on this movie and basically taught Richard Attenborough how to behave as this character Pinky would.
Wow. Yeah. Nice. So, yeah, but there's
also in the movie as a barman who doesn't speak.
So they all attack. They all attack Spicer and are like, look like they're just going to murder him. It's just a fucking huge group of guys that just swarm on him. But then they also attack Pinky and slash him. And of course, Pinky, this is one of the few times in the movie we see Pinky fucking lose it. Like all control, where he's just like, no, you're not supposed to attack me, him. And then he fucking runs off scared. Like that's there's two times I think in this movie we see him super scared. And
because
that's
he's
one of them.
He's all about control.
Exactly.
Right?
He's all about maintaining this face that he has of like this intimidating gangster. And this is one of the only times he gets thrown off that.
Yeah.
And of course, and this was controversial because apparently at the time, slashing a person in the face was enough to be controversial. And so there were a lot of places that wouldn't play it. And
Brighton had a hard time with this too. The tourism board of Brighton did not care for this movie.
And
they
not.
Forced them to put that disclaimer at the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, there's a disclaimer at the beginning saying like, this was Brighton of yesteryear. This is not like the Brighton of today.
Come on down. Be safe. We'll have a great time. You spend all your money and be a tourist. It's cool.
It almost almost a tourist advertisement for Brighton. And I don't know 100% of that, but I mean, just based on the fact that I know Brighton was upset with the movie, I guarantee they pushed for that opening.
Yeah, no question, because they didn't want to ruin their tourism business. And yeah. I think, because I say, I'm pretty sure to this day, Brighton is still a big seaside destination for people in England and
yeah.
Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland and probably even Ireland.
And so, like you mentioned, Spicer is in that ruckus, but he doesn't die. And he comes back later, and that leads to possibly one of the most brutal scenes in the movie.
Yeah, we have a gimmicked railing.
It's a wrestling term railing that's been pre-broken.
And because he walks up to see Spicer and he sees that he's alive or whatever, goes into the room, and we just hear like them talking from outside. And I thought, oh, is he gonna like murder him in the room so we don't see it? But no, he like walks him out of the room and then fucking like kicks him in the gut and sends him through the railing.
And it's such a cold scene too, because right after he's like. The banisters needed work for a while now.
Yeah, exactly. He's just coming up with the story. And he's like, oh, his luggage probably should have fallen with him too. So they toss his luggage down.
Well, that's another character. And that's a character we haven't talked about very much. We haven't talked very much about. And that's the lawyer, Mr. Pruitt.
Yeah.
Because they have a lawyer. They're their gang lawyer. He's the Sean Penn to their Al Pacino. But he doesn't turn on them. And he's so conflicted. Like, that's his character, right? He's conflicted about what he's doing. He's obviously not living a happy life.
No, he's got a very ugly wife, according to him, that he just hates.
And neighbors, which I can relate to, that don't stop fucking banging on the wall or playing music.
Yep.
right there with you, Pruitt. But there's this scene here where he kills Spicer. Pruitt sees that, and you know, without missing a beat, Pinky looks right at him and says, "Well, you saw the accident happen."
Yeah.
And that's what it's going to be. And then even Pruitt, like you said, the line at that point is just like, oh, God, what am I doing? And he's like, oh, throw the briefcase down. I'll wipe it for fingerprints. Yeah. Like, he's telling them what to do, but he's just like,
ugh. Yeah, he clearly doesn't want to do it, but he understands the situation demands it.
And because we're talking about Pruitt, I can't go without playing the scene where Ida, Hermione Baddeley, goes and like finds him.
Yes.
And interrogates him, because there's a lot going on here in terms of like just filmmaking.
Yeah, okay, I have a question before we play this scene, Brendan. So sure. in the novel I read and in the movie, she wins a big bet because she bets on Black Boy, which is the horse that Fred told her to bet on in the race. And I read that in the book, she like is using this money to like bribe everybody to talk to them. Hmm. I didn't notice her in the movie doing that. Did you happen to notice that? I don't know that that bet really came of anything, despite seeing her win that bet.
I don't think she does that in the movie at
all. Okay.
No. But yeah, so let's listen to her interrogate Pruitt. And you'll notice a lot of background sound too, and we'll talk about that.
Mr. Pruitt?
Madam, I haven't the pleasure.
Neither have I, but I've got to see you.
I ought to have made an appointment, but I think I can fit you in before Colonel Pridham arrives.
Does that noise go on all the time?
And I can stand it no more. I beat on the wall. Now, madam. Mm-hmm.
You ought to eat more careful.
Nothing does it any good.
You drink too much.
Glass of the old and crusted. Excuse me.
Now listen, Pruitt. You were there when Spicer got knocked off.
Knocked off?
Killed.
Who are you? It was the banisters. The broken banisters.
Did you do it, or was he there all the time?
I don't know what you're saying.
You look ill, you know. Real bad. I bet you got an ulcer.
No, nothing like that.
You ought to have your inside photograph.
So I love that. I love that scene, and there's just so much going on to make everything kind of uneasy. Like the music next door, he's pounding on the wall to get them to stop. She's in his face.
He's having gastrointestinal problems as well.
But is it that, or is it just that's his guilty thing?
It could be. Either way, he's having a physical manifestation of something. And I don't doubt a guy like a lawyer at this time would have like stomach problems. Of course, probably drinks a lot.
Yeah, probably drinks a lot.
He says he drinks a glass of the old crusted or the old and crusted once in a while, but
which made you audibly gag.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like something I want to drink.
But she says in that scene, she says, you know, I know what she actually means when she says this, but she says your insides should be photographed. But it's also almost a way of saying like you're hiding something, we should take a photograph as in like you should tell us what that is. Like, what are you hiding, kind of thing.
Yeah, give it to me.
Yeah.
I want to know, baby.
I want to know. And he eventually tells her some stuff, right?
Yeah, I think he fills her in a little bit. Yeah. She gets clues from everybody. But then we eventually get to a point where everything's starting to come home to roost. And Pinky's going to make a move.
Well, Pinky is like, at this point, he's like, you know, I've married this girl, but like, it's almost, I think what motivates him is like, he doesn't want to be married to this girl.
No, he doesn't want to deal with her anymore.
He's like, I don't want to actually, like, I think he would rather be arrested than have a quiet married life in the country.
Yeah, he does threaten her kind of at one point, doesn't he? Like, he sits her down and is like, this is how it's going to be, and...
Oh, no, he gets her to agree to a suicide pact.
Well, yeah, eventually. I thought before, though, because in the book, apparently, he threatens her with acid.
Like the drug?
No, no actual like burning acid. We're going to trip balls if you don't help me out here.
I'm going to superdose you.
Yeah. No, so he threatens with acid. And then at the end of the novel, he ends up getting acid on himself before his ultimate fate.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. But he does eventually get to the point where he's like, yeah. Oh, I'm going to make her think it's a suicide pact. But then obviously, yeah. You know, when she does the deed herself, he's just going
to
fuck off.
Yeah, his point is like, look, we'll go together. You don't want to see me hang. So the only thing we can do is we can commit suicide and you kill yourself first and then I'll kill myself and then it'll be all good. And his thought is that, oh, I saw it happen before. Some girl and a guy had a suicide pact and the girl died and the guy survived and they didn't charge the guy. So I'll be fine.
Yeah. Also, Jason, because this movie has had this level of brutality that I didn't expect in a 1947 movie.
Yeah, face slashing. Yeah, you don't expect that shit.
Because of that, I thought, shit, this might happen. Yeah. She might die. They might stop him. They will stop him because it's a movie in the 40s. Mm. But she could be a casualty here.
Yeah, exactly. The movie has been brutal enough so far that you certainly will allow that could happen.
Yeah.
In the course of this movie.
And it's a really intense finale.
Yeah. Yeah, this poor woman.
And you get this character who we get this thing we didn't really talk about a lot about William Hartnell, the first Doctor Who?
Yes.
Yeah. Who plays
Is it Dowell or
Dally?
Dally,
that's Dally. He plays Dally, and he's the one that kind of gets a conscience. And his girl, his girlfriend is named Judy.
Yeah, he seems like
his wife.
He seems like the most morally respectable of the gangsters. Like he doesn't seem like a crazy person. Like he seems like a moderating influence on Pinky to some extent.
He's like De Niro in most of Goodfellas.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
Like where he does the job, and if he has to kill someone, he will, but he doesn't go out of his way to do something that is unnecessary.
No, exactly. I mean, and these are all older guys that have more experience than Pinky, of course. But right. They're not psychopaths, certainly in the same way that Pinky is.
In this movie, Rose takes the gun. She's about to do it. Of course, they stop her from doing it. And Pinky falls into the water and dies.
Yeah, he kind of gets, he has that second moment where he finally breaks because the cops are coming in. Yeah. She isn't dead.
And she throws the gun in the water.
She throws the gun in the water. So he's lost his last like line of defense at that point. And he kind of, like I say, in the book, he like spills acid on himself and then falls into the water. But in the movie, it seems like he's just scared and then like trips and falls. And that's that.
And that, yeah, he dies. And then Jason, we had to talk about the very ending of this movie.
Yes, we do.
And maybe we'll just play it. And then we'll talk about it, obviously. But, like, you know, Rose is in the room with a nun.
Yeah.
And she's talking about it.
Which, by the way, in the book, I believe is a priest.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah.
But she's talking about Pinky. And in the finale of this scene, she finally gets to play the gramophone. And let's listen. We heard that message earlier. So let's hear that.
That woman said he wanted to get rid of me. She doesn't know a thing about love.
Perhaps she was right, Richard.
And you don't either. I know. I've got proof. I've got his voice. I don't want to be forgiven. I'm afraid of missing him.
My child, there's always hope. It's the air we breathe. You can't understand, nor I, nor anyone for that matter. The appalling strangeness of the mercy of God. We have to hope and pray.
I want to help, but I don't know how.
You say he loved you. There's hope.
Even that sort of love.
Any love.
He loved me. I'll show you he loved me. Mother, can I?
if you want to.
You asked me to make a record of my voice. And here it is. What you want me to say is I love you. 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 I love you.
So earlier there was a scene where he was trying to break the record because she finally get a gramophone player.
He tried to smash it on his shoe, but didn't have much luck.
He couldn't smash it because those things are tough as fuck.
Yeah.
And he did, though, manage to get it to skip, as you heard, and it skips on I love you, I love you, I love you. So she never finds out that he was a bastard who never cared one iota for her. Now, apparently, the movie was going to end with her hearing the whole thing and being devastated, and that was how it was going to end. Now,
I think that's in the book, but I wasn't able to get full confirmation.
It is in the book. I believe you're right. Now, they changed the ending to this because they thought the censors wouldn't allow them to end the movie on such a down note in, 1947. And Graham Greene, the author, has gone on record to say, like, he thought this ending was not good. Like, he said it was too sappy, it was too happy. I think this is sadder.
Yeah.
Don't you?
It is certainly more tragic, and it's part of the reason why I don't think I like this movie quite as much as you.
Oh.
I like this movie a lot, don't get me wrong. But this ending is such a cruel, tragic twist for her. Because this is the sort of situation that leads to the old lady from Great Expectations. This is a woman who, she is 17 years old, and she is going to spend the rest of her life pining for her beautiful husband that died so tragically and thinking that he was this great thing, and she'll never move on from it. And to do that to her in this movie, yeah, you're right, Brendan, it is so much more tragic and cruel than giving her the truth and as much as it would hurt her, allowing her to move on with her life. Like, that's what got me, is that this woman, this character in this movie, is so goddamn naive throughout the whole movie. And because of this ending, she never stops being naive.
But that's why I kind of like the ending.
I mean, I appreciate it from that perspective, but like, I feel it's so mean to that character that she doesn't leave with any sort of like perspective on what happened, that she's left with this illusion because of this fucking damage to this record. And honestly, if she fucked around with it, she could hear the rest of it. Like, at some point, surely she must, if she's going to fucking play this thing over and over. Eventually, it's going to get past the skip and work.
Well, Graham Greene also said, in the world of this movie, she definitely at some point picked up the needle, put it back down and heard the rest of the message.
Yeah, she would have had to have.
They put an ad out in the newspaper for this character to cast her. Do you know what the ad said?
Need a tight girl.
no, a little bit more descriptive. Okay. They said they needed someone who was frail, innocent, naive, and tolerably but not excessively pretty.
I mean, sure. I mean, I think
tolerably pretty.
I was gonna say, I think she's very attractive in this movie. Oh, I think she's very good looking. Sure. But yeah, she definitely has that kind of innocence about her. She doesn't look super fancy. She's just like a young girl, high school girl.
She was interviewed 50 years after this movie came out in '97, and she said she had never seen the movie and she couldn't bear to.
I understand that. That's the Adam Driver thing. Like, I get it. It sometimes can be hard to watch yourself or listen to yourself. It's why I have a hard time listening to this podcast back, as much as Brendan hates that.
Yeah, listen to yourself, you bitch.
I just feel weird walking down the street laughing to myself.
I do it. To you.
Well, you should. I'm very funny.
But I think it's also just the role. I think it was such a... her knowing how the movie ends, it's just so hard to listen, to watch that.
It is very hard.
I think that was in 97. I mean, she's since passed away. I think she went her whole life without seeing the movie, or at least that's what she says.
It's on the BFI list, lady. You should have watched it.
Well, hold on now.
I bet you she saw A Taste of Honey.
Well, probably. It's her favorite film.
Yeah, clearly.
Do you know that also that Brighton Rock in America, it was called Young Scarface?
Which is totally makes sense for the era. Absolutely.
I mean, the 30s, 1933.
But also to the point where Brighton Rock as an item, as a candy, wouldn't make any sense to an American. It didn't make any sense to me until I read it, you know.
Because I think the original Scarface was 1930s, and they also had the movie Little Caesar with Mickey Rooney, maybe.
Does Mickey Rooney make pizza in that movie?
Yeah, of course. That's obviously. It's a biopic about the
where the restaurant began. Caesar. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. but I just thought that was interesting that it was retitled. But it makes sense. Like you said, the Brighton Rock phrase doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. I think that's it before Bits and Bobs.
Sure.
You think?
Yeah. Yeah, all right. I don't have a whole lot.
Okay, well, we're going to take a brief break, and we will be right back.
Age of Radio.
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
Bits and Bobs.
Bits and Bobs. Then we got us fucking Bits and Bobs, and I drank a beer, so I'm singing about Bits and Bobs.
Bits and Bobs. Bits and Bobs. Bits and Bobs. Bits and Bobs. The Bits and the Bobs.
Thank you, Brendan.
Bits and Bobs and Bits and Bobs, okay. And Bits and Bobs and Bits, and Bobs and Bits and Bobs and Bits, and Bobs and Bits and Bobs.
I thought I was the one that liked to go on and on.
Bits and Bobs, Bits and Bobs, Bits and Bobs.
All right, we got Bits and Bobs, goddammit. Jesus Christ.
What's a call? Bits and Bobs. Da-da-da-da-da. Bits and makes me Bob good. I ain't afraid of no Bits and Bobs.
Hey, step off.
Bits and Bobs.
Once again, upfront credits. Everybody do it.
That's an order.
As we explained, Carol Marsh, by permission, had been let out of her slave contract to go and be in this movie. I'm sure they must have made like 15 quid a week.
And of course, as I said, and I'll state it again, bring back that studio system.
Lots of uncomfortable beach footage, only uncomfortable because there's a lot of people close together, and the pandemic is still not over as of this recording.
And apparently, a lot of that footage, by the way, especially when they're going through crowds, they had hidden cameras.
Oh, nice.
And the crowds do not know they're being filmed. They're real crowds.
That's cool.
That's crazy for 1947.
But that's also neat. You think about, like, look at all these people in this scene. Like, every person has a story, and all of them are dead.
You're a dark individual with a dark soul.
Let's see. Local race track gang. I wrote local race gang. They were not a race gang in the sense that they were fighting other races. They just didn't like racetracks, I guess.
They were fighting at the races.
Yeah. That Pinky doesn't drink or smoke or do anything is an interesting thing for this character, because in any other movie, this guy'd probably be a bad alcoholic. He'd probably be smoking Brighton Rock.
Well, it goes into that idea. Yeah. It goes into that idea of, like, him being a Catholic, right? Mm-hmm. It's just like, you can be a Catholic. It doesn't mean you're a good person.
I was going to say, but also, lots of Catholic priests like to drink a lot.
Yeah.
A lot.
I mean, I know I did.
Like, a lot.
I'm a
hammered all the time.
I'm a Catholic priest, Jason.
Well,
I have decreed it. It is so.
You may want to talk to Mariah about that.
Moving on.
Especially because of her huge penis.
hey, you said it now.
Pinky seems really angry. He's just an angry guy. That's what I wrote.
Okay. What about the scene where Hermione Baddeley is like doing like a psychic reading?
Yeah, that was a weird thing where she's doing like a parlor trick where she's plunging her pen into the paper and taking the random letters and then using that to like come up with something that is relevant. And yeah, she does over the course of the movie figure out what all these random letters mean.
But I think also she just figures it out otherwise.
Yeah.
But yeah. I think that I thought that was a weird scene. I was like, wait, is that what we're doing?
When Fred's running down the street, that's a great shot. But I love the scenery of Brighton at this time. Like, I really like seeing all the billboards and everything. Like, I saw an advertisement for Bovril. Do you know Bovril, Brendan?
No, tell me.
Bovril is like a beef jelly almost that you would then stir into hot water to make a drink. And you would drink it in the mornings to go to school with the goodness of beef in your belly.
I always enjoy the goodness of beef in my belly, Jason.
I know you do, Brendan, and you can still buy it today. You might even be able to actually get it at Walmart here because they have a little like 4-foot British food section.
They're not a sponsor.
No, but they do have British stuff, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I forgive everything else they've done.
I thought Fred was just desperate for companionship at first, but it's more just to keep himself alive.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, at one point, there's a game there that... Pinky is playing. It's like a carnival game, and among the prizes you can get at the carnival game are cigarettes. That's fucking awesome.
That's not still a thing?
No, apparently not. You can't just hand out cigarettes to kids at the carnival.
Oh.
Pinky slashes a dude's face for not paying him. So we get another slashing. I forgot about that one.
Right. That was the first one, actually. That was the first time I was like, whoa. Because he slashes him. It's kind of off screen, but then it cuts to him. You see the slash and he's holding back and you see a lot of blood.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's almost a fucking Yojimbo.
300 over here.
Yeah. Oh, she's in the show. That explains the outfit. I was very happy when I realized that.
Ida
was in the review.
Yeah.
Okay, so Black Boy is a good name for a horse, but it's slightly offensive.
Not as bad as another name not for
as,
an animal.
Certainly not as bad as a dog in the Dam Busters, but I guess you could call a horse that because horses are black and brown.
But you shouldn't call
gray.
A dog that, no. Despite a dog being black.
No. Maybe we avoid that. But Black Boy came in 10-1. That's good odds.
I will say there's a cool trope that I probably wasn't a trope in 1947, but it's that trope of like a gangster movie where you have the cop character that's like, listen, I'm gonna have this event, and I know I know who all the criminals are, but I don't want you fucking with each other and ruining it for everyone else.
That trope of like the police and the criminals having close contact,
an understanding,
but also like just communication with each other to some extent because they do encounter each other on a regular basis. And then he's not just dragging him in there to arrest him. Like
that feels very familiar nowadays. Like there are so many movies where, you know, you have at least one cop and one criminal that are just like on some sort of speaking terms. Like, you know.
I just wanted to point out that Pruitt has a snuff box.
The lawyer.
Yeah, the lawyer has a snuff box.
I did notice that.
Takes
a
little huff off that.
Yep. There's a cool flashback thing. We didn't really talk a lot about the scene where Ida goes in to talk to Rose at the restaurant because she tries to get answers out of her.
Yeah.
And that's when that's the first time she tries to save Rose. I mean, essentially for the movie, because she realizes Rose has been led astray by Pinky and thinks that he loves her. And Rose is not a very good liar. And she says something like, you know, oh, he came in. Yes, it was him. It was for sure. The journalist, and he ordered a bottle of beer and then he left. And Ida remembers there's a little flashback audio thing where he says, like, I don't trust bottled beer.
Yeah, he's like, it doesn't sit well with me. So she knows he doesn't drink bottled beer, so she knows that's a lie.
Yeah, exactly.
Pinky doesn't like being laughed at because at one point there's a bunch of them laughing about Pinky and he comes into the scene and it just makes him angry.
Mm-hmm.
He has no sense of humor whatsoever.
No.
I've never seen him laugh. I've never seen him like crack a joke. He has very little...
And his only smile is a sinister smile.
Exactly. When something is... Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. When something bad is going to happen his way. They keep saying wife can't give evidence. Again, I'm not sure if that's a law. I think there is some law, some precedence to that. Pinky calls her a slut on the gramophone. Very out there.
Is Pruitt, at the beginning of the scene, before Pruitt gets interrogated by Ida, by Hermione Baddeley, is he stealing coffee from someone's estate? Because the box he's taking grounds from says the estate of some something something, and he's just scooping up coffee and or tea and putting it in his cup, and I'm like, is he stealing that from a dead person?
That's awesome. That's great. I hope so.
Great little detail.
I hope so.
That scummy lawyer thing.
I think at one point, I think it's Pinky. So he hears a baby crying in the distance, and he gets really mad, and he slams the window closed, and then you can't hear that baby anymore. So props to that window for being so soundproof.
And you thought of me.
I thought of you, absolutely.
There's a baby next door, guys. It's the worst.
Well, it's a baby. God.
No, the baby should be killed.
Yeah, the whole suicide pact thing. I'll show you. He loved me. That's what I wrote down. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the poor woman. That poor woman. Poor Rose. God, I have so much sympathy for her more than just about any other character I've seen. I feel like she was hard done by.
That we've talked about so far, yeah. All right, well, are those your bits and bobs?
Those are the bits and bobs.
Well, I want to talk about when this movie came out, because you kind of alluded to this earlier, but it caused a bit of an uproar in Britain, due to its depiction of violence. They said the razor slashing scenes were horrific, and saying this film must not be shown. Like, they were very adamant about it. It was banned in New South Wales.
Wow.
New
South Wales doesn't ban anything except video games that are too violent.
But it was very popular with British audiences.
They're all bloodthirsty fucking motherfuckers, ultimately.
It was a, quote, notable box office attraction. I have a number here, but I don't know how accurate it is. It says £190,147 is what it made at the box office. I'm sure it was more than that, but...
Certainly in the 80 years or so since it was made.
Yeah. But it was less popular in the U.S., but its violence, weirdly, was not considered excessive in the U.S.
Well, doesn't that just speak to America? Violence is fine, but titties, yeehaw! If you show titties or bush or a dick, it's a problem.
Titties, bush, dick, rated R.
That's my new punk band, Titties, Bush, and Dick.
Nice.
We love Titties, Bush, and Dick. This is our song, Titties, Bush, and Dick. So it's just like
two dumb Fox News guys.
Yeah.
George W. Bush. And Richard Attenborough, the ghost of him.
And Dolly Parton.
Sure, because... Just titties. Because?
Titties.
Oh, okay. I thought the boobs were just going to be a couple boobs from Fox.
Well, Dolly has to keep them all in line.
Zing, zang, zing!
Man, I wonder how many podcasts make a Dolly Parton boob joke these days. Probably not many.
Us.
Just us, baby. We're old school!
Suck it, other podcasts.
You guys like Hello Fada, Hello Mutta? Here I am at Camp Granada. That's a great song. Check it out.
This movie came out at a time that was like, I think, just before the BAFTAs started. Yeah. So nothing at the BAFTAs. Nothing at the Oscars.
Rationing was still going on. This was a rough time.
It was a rough time, guys. It was a rough time. But that being said, Brighton Rock. Jason, final thoughts.
Really cool movie, really enjoyable. Richard Attenborough is fantastic in this movie. Carol Marsh is fantastic as Rose. Hermione Baddeley is fantastic as Ida. I mean, it's a really cool kind of morality play gangster picture hybrid. Like, it's not your typical, it's not like Goodfellas, but it is that. And despite my dislike of how that character turns out, it's a fantastic movie, and you would do yourself disservice to miss it.
And it's 92 minutes, and it's a tight 92 minutes. Like, there's no waste of time.
No.
It gets from point A to point B to point C. Like, this thing moves.
This is no Dambusters, friends.
No. Night and day. this is more in the line. This thing moves. If I could compare it to another older movie that with this kind of pace, it's like 39 steps.
Yeah.
Like, it just keeps going.
Yeah.
And it's very much like, you know, it's one thing. You know, you're seeing if they can catch this guy, and he's trying to cover his tracks. So it all takes place over the course of like maybe a day or two.
Yeah, it's a very focused story.
Yeah. So I wasn't sure what to expect, and kind of reminded me of when we walked into The Servant not knowing
what
we were
going to get. Yes, exactly. Absolutely, for sure.
This is a great fucking movie. Yeah. I knew there was something up when I saw that it was number 15. Yeah. I knew there had to be something that was pulling this thing along.
That's right, absolutely.
And it's wonderful. I love it. I think this is like a perfect movie. I know I might like it a little bit more than Jason. You said it was fantastic. So
I say it is great.
Like it.
It is great. I don't know if it's a perfect movie because in my mind, the perfect movie is Predator, but it's pretty good.
The Predator, though. The new one.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Just because you're a big Keegan-Michael Key fan.
Love
and
guy.
Thomas Jane.
He's wonderful.
But I love this movie so much. It's perfect. I love it.
Hashtag bring Thomas Jane back as the Punisher.
Hashtag Richard Attenborough, make a sequel. Wait. It's a long hashtag.
All right, tell you what, David Attenborough, since you're still alive, of the three Attenborough brothers, you're the only one alive. You make the sequel.
Or, you know, Richard Dreyfuss. Let's do it.
Yeah, he's old enough.
Yeah. I'd love to see Richard Dreyfuss as old Pinky.
Yeah.
The scariest man ever.
Well, given that Richard Attenborough has such a like a career playing like likable characters, it wouldn't be crazy. How often does Richard Dreyfuss actually play a bad guy?
Don't know if he ever has, but I'm sure he has.
Surely he must have at one point.
Yeah. So that's Brighton Rock, number 15 on the list. But now, Jason, we need to find out what we are going to talk about on next week's episode. We are going to draw the next movie out of an envelope that is on the BFI Top 100. And as we get closer and closer, I pine for Carry On Up the Khyber.
We have Carry On Up the Khyber that we're certainly looking forward to see what that is. But we also have some very 3-hour movies ahead of us. Very 3-hour. So who knows what's going to happen. I have this envelope. It is a white envelope and is written in black marker BFI Top 100. So you know it's official.
Very professional.
Very professional. And I'm going to hand this over to Brendan. I'm going to hold the envelope so he can't hold it because I don't trust him. And then he's going to draw out the movie and then he will hand it to me. You can hear it now rustling through as he fishes out a movie that we will watch.
And I want you to tell me the number first.
Number first?
Yeah. All right. What do we got?
So number first is... number 79.
Oh, damn it.
And that movie is Far From the Maddening Crowd.
Okay, well, let's do it.
All right. Is this the 3-hour
this
one?
This is the Julie Christie... don't put it back in. No, Jason. That is why we switched from the dice. This is near 3 hours. This is a Julie Christie and a whirlwind romance. I'm kind of glad we're getting to it though, because there's a director who is going to pop up 3 times.
This guy. Wow.
He directed Darling.
Yeah.
He directed this, and he directed 2 more movies yet to come.
Wow. He's like getting approaching David Lean for movies on the list.
John Schlesinger. He also directed Midnight Cowboy.
That's crazy that we've only seen 1 movie of his so far.
Right? And we did David Lean's already.
Yeah, all of them.
All right. Well, fuck. All right, let's do it. We're going to do Far From the Madding Crowd, next week on this show. Could be a 4-hour episode.
Might have to watch that one on Saturday night, or at least to have a 2-hour movie extravaganza.
Could be 45 minutes.
Two-night movie extravaganza.
Yeah, I don't know. I might have to do that too.
Maybe I'll watch it at 2.5 times speed.
Could surprise us. It could surprise us. I don't have high hopes though.
We'll see.
We'll talk about the next week. But Jason, until then, they can find us on social media. They can find us on Twitter at @BFI_pod. They can find us on Facebook. Just search for Screen.
And Gundre.
And we're on all the podcast apps. Our home base is Age of Radio, of course, ageofradio.org/forscreeningcountry. You can find Jason.
At Jason D. McLeod. That's MacLeod over on Twitter. Just hanging out. Just chilling. Just reading shit. So let me know you're there. Say hi. Say hey. Say ho ho, baby.
And be sure to go over and tell Jason that he's the C-103 $10,000 fugitive.
That's right.
He will deny it.
Yeah.
But well, pay
no,
you.
I'm not going to give you any money. No.
No.
I have no money. I have no money to give you.
Oh. That's kind of rude.
Now, if you out there want to donate money, I will then not give that money to somebody else.
Yeah. Donate to the C-103 $10,000 fugitive Kickstarter. Right.
It's a worthy cause.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's pretty much it. So we'll talk about Far From the Madding Crowd. Well, at least we're getting the first 3-hour movie under our belt, and not getting them all in a row. Although we don't know.
Colonel Blimp may very well be the week after.
And then fucking Oliver, we're all in a row. But until next week, I guess all I have to say to you is God save the Queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, well, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
Bye.
Bye. We're going to go near a madding crowd right now.
On Brighton Rock.
And we're going to eat some candy and smoke some Brighton Rock.
One evening as the sun went down and the jungle fire was burning, down the track came a hobo hiking. And he said, boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away beside the crystal fountain. So come with me, we'll go and see the Big Rock Candy Mountains. In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, there's a land that's fair and bright, where the handouts grow on bushes and you sleep out every night, where the boxcars all are empty and the sun shines every day on the birds and the bees and the cigarette trees, the lemonade springs where the bluebird sings in the Big Rock Candy Mountains. In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, all the cops have wooden legs, and the bulldogs all have rubber teeth, and the hens lay soft-boiled eggs. The farmer's trees are full of fruit, and the barns are full of hay. Oh, I'm bound to go where there ain't no snow, where the rain don't fall, the wind don't blow, in the Big Rock Candy Mountains. In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, you never change your socks, and the little streams of alcohol come a-trickling down the rocks. The brakemen have to tip their hats, and the railroad bulls are blind. There's a lake of stew and a whiskey too. You can paddle all around them in a big canoe in the Big Rock Candy Mountains. In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, the jails are made of tin, and you can walk right out again as soon as you are in. There ain't no short-handled shovels, no axes, saws, or picks. I'm a-going to stay where you sleep all day, where they hung the Turk that invented work in the Big Rock Candy Mountains. I'll see you all this coming fall in the Big Rock Candy Mountains.